speak to the topic of accountability. Accountability is something that everyone needs one way or another. When you're not held accountable for your actions will become very aberrant and a breaking of God's moral, spiritual, and holy law, and a breaking of man's law as well. Why do we have a country overrun with criminals? Because the criminals are not held accountable. They're slapped on the wrist, returned to the public over and over again. And these criminals then continue to perpetrate crimes against their fellow man simply because there is no punishment or there is no repercussion for their ill doings. I just watched yesterday on the television the sentencing of a man to death for raping and murdering a 9-year-old girl. And I was really very pleased to hear that sentence meted out. Because whoso sheddeth man's blood, his blood shall be shed by man. That's chapter 9 of Genesis. The rule of God, the law of God given through Moses at that time. And that rule has never been abrogated. It has never been broken or done away with by any words in the New Testament of any apostle, prophet, or the Lord Jesus Christ himself. So when there's the deterrent of punishment or public shunning or public correction, then there's an impediment to sin. Now, we as Christians don't desire to sin. I believe that anybody that's born again and washed in the blood, when you become saved, you're given a new heart that shows you the difference between truth and error, right and wrong. You're given a new spirit which guides and directs and leads you into all truth. And you begin to become aware very, very quickly of the evil that you used to do and of the evil that you want to abstain from. There's things that you used to do that you don't do anymore because you are a Christian. And whether or not you have wicked thoughts, wicked imaginations come into your mind, you ought not to let them take over and rule your body. And I've expressed and said repeatedly throughout the whole time I've been preaching, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that what you do with your body is very important. Because your body and what you do with your body exemplifies what's being done or what's going on in your heart. Where your heart is, there will be your treasure also. And if your heart's with Jesus in heaven, you'll be a heavenly person. You'll walk in the light of heaven, and you'll walk as an heir of the inheritance of the saints in light. Now, the Bible, particularly 1st and 2nd Timothy and Titus, along with other passages in the New Testament, is very explicit about how we ought to conduct ourselves. And just for an example, we're going to turn to 1 Timothy chapter 5, and I will lay particular emphasis on verse 22, but we want to look at the context a little bit. I'm not going to read the whole chapter. I have a whole nother sermon to preach after this, so I'm not going to belabor the point. I want to bring to your remembrance, if it has been in your mind in the past, and if not, point it out to your conscience and your heart and your mind, some of the things that the Lord said through the Apostle Paul in 1 Timothy. Now, Timothy was a young preacher, and Paul was writing to him to encourage him and give him further instructions about how he ought to conduct himself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. That's 1 Timothy 3, verse 15, I just cited there. But now, in 1 Timothy chapter 5, Paul here speaks to the care of widows in the verses leading up to, verse 16? And then verse 17, he says, let the elders that rule well, look at that word, rule. There were elders that ruled in the church that Timothy pastored. There were other men that were in positions of authority besides Timothy. And they were to rule well, and they were, if they ruled well, and they recognized that being a good servant of Jesus Christ to the Lord and to the Lord's people, They were to be counted worthy of double honor. That's of an honor above just someone that's doing their job and no more. These men excelled and they were worthy of double honor. Especially, particular importance is brought to those that labor in the word and in doctrine. The Bible, in the New Testament, particularly in the Pauline epistles, but the speech of the Lord Jesus Christ as well, laid heavy emphasis upon doctrine. That is the teaching of God, that is the faith of Jesus Christ and pertains to the faith of Jesus Christ. The doctrine of God is to be adorned with godly behavior. The faith of Jesus Christ and the profession of faith in Jesus Christ is to be adorned by a godly, that is an upright, honest conversation by the professors thereof in this world. We are to honor the Lord Jesus Christ, not just with our lips, but with the thoughts and intents of our hearts and with the deeds of our body. We're to bring our body into subjection, like Paul said he did his, lest we should be castaways. That is, fall into the condemnation of the devil, be condemned to the devil, and be a shame and a reproach to the cause of Jesus Christ in the world. So let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and in doctrine. For the scripture saith, thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out the corn, and the laborer is worthy of his reward. That's not just an honor, but that's referring to being supported in the ministry, I believe, as well, and it's been used as such in the past by many men of God. Then it says, against an elder, that's one who's a ruler in the church or the one who has a position of authority, whether it's to be authority in the ministration to widows, whether it's one who's teaching and training up young people, catechizing people, however it might be, against an elder receive not an accusation, but before two or three witnesses. Them that sin rebuke before all, that others also may fear. There, that passage is very plain. Those that were in open, wanton sin and had been confronted about it, individually and particularly by the pastor or by one of the elders, and they did not recant or did not repent of their sin and turn again to seek to do God's will instead of their own will, then they were to be confronted a second time. And this is according to the words of the Lord Jesus in the Synoptic Gospels. And if they were impenitent, then they were to be taken before the whole church. This is the church order or discipline for malefactors, as our church covenant read. And we are to be accountable one to another. If I begin to engage in wanton, aberrant, sinful behavior that's visible to the eyes of man and to your eyes, you are to reprove me, rebuke me, and seek to turn me from the error of my ways. I'm to do the same with any of you, and you're to do the same one with another. What is the great bane of our society today? What is the great problem in America? That no one is accountable for the deeds that they do. They're not held accountable. And the reason our public servants are in no wise accountable to the people that they elected, that were elected, that elected them, the reason this is going on is because people aren't held accountable in their local churches. These blabbit and grabbit churches, these churches that wish blessings and peace to all that pass by, these apostate houses of Baal, these places full of dead men's bones, filled with hypocrisy and hypocritical professions of faith, these purported Christian churches are no Christian churches at all, but they are synagogues of Satan. This is no synagogue of Satan. This is a church of the living God, who is the pillar and ground of the truth. The church is the pillar and ground of the truth, but the church is the pillar and ground of the truth pillar has to do, it's a, with witness and testimony. We are to have a good testimony and be a good witness, and hence be part of a local assembly, which is a pillar and a ground. That is a place that can be found where there is truth. You can't preach the truth unless you do the truth. If I was an abject, I don't say that I'm sinless. I've never professed that. I never will profess that. The great conundrum to me, after I was washed in the blood, born again and saved, after God showed me that Christ, by his work, had caused all my sins to be forgiven, the great conundrum, the great problem I faced, had to reconcile, not by any teaching of any pastor, not by any teaching of any brother to me, unfortunately. You can't get it that way very easily these days. But the problem I had was that in my flesh dwelt no good thing. That even though I'd been born again, even though I had a new spirit, I still had within me the motions of sin which worked death in my mortal members. And I had to resolve that. And the only way I could resolve that was by going to the Bible, seeking God's face, and desiring of Him. When we pray, that's expressing desires. But also, when we come to the Word of God, we can simply have the desire to know, believe, and walk in the truth. And when we present ourselves before God through His Word, we come before Him. When we come to His Word, we come to Jesus Christ, seeking that which is good, seeking for Him. I have to pray and be prayed up to preach. I can't come and do my duty without seeking God's face, and I don't do it as well when I'm not prayed up and haven't sought His face. And when you've sought His face, sought His Word, and heard from God, then He that runneth may read Christ in your life, in your speech, and in your behavior. The outworking of the faith of Jesus Christ is righteousness ruling and reigning in His people's hearts by love. And I don't say that we're sinless, but my problem was that I couldn't figure out how there could be so much sin in me when I'd come to realize that Christ was in me. Then I saw in the Bible that Christ was in the midst of His disciples. He gave them power to work miracles, to cleanse the lepers, heal the sick, raise the dead, to cast out devils. They had freely received and they were freely to give. But they did that, and then 5 minutes later they could be a hot carnal mess desiring their own glory. That in itself was instructive to me. And then John's first epistle, chapter 1 and chapter 3, I found out that he that is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him. The seed of God remains in you, and your new man does not commit sin. But then John also said, back in the first chapter of his first epistle, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So, we have indwelling sin, but most importantly, what gives us hope is we have an indwelling Savior. And the Bible teaches us that our bodies, it says, know ye not that ye are the temple of God? And he that defileth the temple of God, him will God destroy. So you're speaking to Christians in the Corinthian church that you're not to defile your body. You're not to even defile your mind. The Bible places a great emphasis on what? Doctrine. And what does the doctrine of God place a great emphasis on? Purity of mind, purity of heart, purity of life. The more purity in your life, the more of Jesus people are going to see in you. The more purity in your life, the more boldness you're going to be, the more bold you're going to be to reprove and rebuke and be a light to other people that are in darkness. You're going to be a city that is set on a hill and cannot be hid. Now, he said, them that sin rebuke before all, that others may fear. And some of you hearing my voice had to do this in your own family, or have not had the opportunity to do it in your own family, but you've made it known. The verse I'm going to emphasize in a moment. Then Paul says, I charge thee. This is a charge. This is a stern admonition and declaration and direction given before God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels, verse 21 of 1 Timothy 5, that thou observe these things without preferring one before another, doing nothing by partiality. Today, in our governmental structure, there's the preferring of one man before another, and these people that profess to be public servants are not even held to the same rules that we are. They can get away with things that would put us in jail. They have special privileges. They are what's called an elite because there's partiality and preference. But here in the Church of God, there can be no preferring one before another. We're all to be held to the same rule. You ought not to do anything that you would condemn another for doing. You ought not to engage in a behavior that if you saw it engaged in by others would cause you to have pause and think that that behavior was sin or had the appearance of sin. So, we're told that the Church of the Living God is a place where everybody is equal. And the only one, the pastor isn't above the laity. In a sense he is, but in a real sense he's accountable to Jesus Christ and accountable to his fellow man the same way all of us are. There's no preference one above another. There was no preference in the Old Testament when it was written, the soul that sinneth it shall die. That was without partiality, without discrimination. There can't be any partiality, can't be any old good buddy system where people are favored simply because of what they give, what they do, or who they are. We all must be held accountable to the same standard. If this nation were a godly nation or had godly people in it to the extent that it used to, like it did in the early 1800s, the chief executives would have been held to the same standard the population held each other to. Back then, there were churches that admonished, disciplined, corrected, instructed, expunged and shunned, disobedient. And those were the kind of things that were going on then. There was a rule of law in the government to which all men recognized was an equal rule for every single person. Now, verse 22. Paul gives an admonition to Timothy. He says, lay hands suddenly on no man, neither be partaker of other men's sins. Keep thyself pure. You see how those two things are attached? Be not partaker of other men's sins. Keep yourself pure. Don't dirty yourself up by condoning or being a partaker of the sins of other men. That word men there is indiscriminate. It refers to the lost and the saved. You don't want to condone a lost man in fornication, in drunkenness and idolatry. You don't want to be a partaker with him in his sins. You don't want to give countenance, as the way used to be said, giving countenance. You don't give countenance to a man who's in a state of sin and walking in a state of sin. Your separation from the world is such that you need to be separated from those that are in gross, impenitent, and habitual sin. Neither be partaker of other men's sins. That includes those that go by the admonition or the name of brother. you're not to be, if I'm in sin, you're not to be partaker of my sins. You're not to indulge yourself with me in my sins or encourage me in my sins. What is the gospel? What is the giving forth of the gospel? The gospel is a word of reconciliation to the unsaved elect and to those that mourn for their sins and are sorry for them and want to know how to get out of their sin. But the gospel is a condemnation to those that do not receive it. Jesus preached hell, fire, and damnation more than any other person in either testament. He preached it with a stronger, more stern, and severe authority than anybody else, because he himself was the fashioner or creator of hell. And he warned men of hell, understanding full well the eternality of hell and the damnation thereof. No one stood against sin like the Lord Jesus Christ. And we'll get to that more later in my sermon. But now a little bit more and I'll be done. Hebrews chapter 13. What ought a Christian in a church to do? Ought you be open to instruction? Ought you be, well, you wouldn't be here right now if you didn't want instruction from God's word. I'm a preacher, but while I'm preaching, I'm teaching you the word of God. And I'm amazed at what my wife knows that I didn't know she knew. Circumstances come up in our lives. She'll start running off and she may not be able to name the place in the scripture, but she can quote or refer to different verses in the Bible. I'm thinking to myself, where did you get that? And she always says, well, I got that listening to you. I'm not boasting or bragging. I'm shocked that God does anything through me. You know, those that sin openly and against their own consciences and against the word of God, they say to God, I'm holier than thou. Get thou from me. Every sin, by whomever it is committed, is a renunciation of the rule of God over your life. It's a negating of the rule of God and saying, I know better than God. I'm smarter than God. I know what's right and what's wrong. Or I know what I feel I ought to do, and I'm going to go by my feelings instead of God's facts. Well, Hebrews 13, verse 7. Remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. That's Jesus Christ, the same, yesterday and today and forever. Remember them which have the rule over you. Obviously, in the New Testament church, there are some that have a spiritual authority over others. The word rule is a verb transitive. It means to govern, to control the will and actions of others, either by arbitrary power or authority, or by established laws. God has his laws established in the New Testament for us. I don't preach that we follow the Old Testament. I preached and have preached for many, many years, we follow the New Testament. And that's our rule of action. That's our rule of life. I seek to follow it. You seek to follow it. So it's to govern, to control the will and actions of others by authority or by established laws. The emperors of the East, this is a definition, rule their subjects without the restraints of a constitution. In limited governments, men are ruled by known laws. The church, the living God, is a limited government of man, because it's really the government of God. And men that rule in the church are limited by the word of God themselves. How many judges are condemn a thief if they're a thief themselves? Sooner or later they'll get caught, Lord willing, but you got to first be clear in a matter before you can call out somebody else on the matter. And that word rule, actually Webster uses it from 1 Timothy 3:5 as a definition of his word rule in his dictionary. If a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Those in a man's household need to be in subjection to him before he can have authority or rule or teach or instruct others in the church of God. That's where authority comes from in human terms. It comes from God, but at the same time, it comes to those and upon those who are in subjection themselves to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, it also means, rule means to govern the movement of things, to conduct, to manage, to control. That God rules the world he has created is a fundamental article of belief. Then again, Hebrews 13, 17. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves. That's obviously speaking to certain persons in certain local assemblies. Speaking to certain persons with certain persons ruling over them in local assemblies. Need I say any more? The Bible doesn't say that the kingdom of God and the kingdom of Christ have no rules and it's just right. Church house is a place for the assembled saints of God who seek to do all things decently, decently and in order. And then one more time, Hebrews 13, 24. Salute all them that have the rule over you and all the saints. They of Italy salute you. So three times in the book of Hebrews, we find that there are those that rule over the assemblies of God in the local church. It's as simple as that. When we don't have our local magistrates and the local police, the local attorney generals, national attorney generals enforcing the rule of law in this country, it's because there is no rule, no order. Things aren't being done decently in order in local churches. May it not be so with us. Amen and amen.